So condemnation there across the political spectrum for Fraser Anning. But one of the most sort of, one of the biggest headlines that we've had has been around this egg boy who smashed an egg on Fraser Anning's head. You can see it happening right there. It was in Melbourne. Now, the question here is, does a story like this do good or bad to the public debate in Australia? It certainly received a lot of support there for the egg boy himself. He's become a national hero for some. In fact, his real name is Will Connolly. He's launched himself right into the spotlight, which includes a huge number of memes, hundreds of thousands of online followers, and upwards of $30,000 via a GoFundMe page. The money is said to be mostly going to the Christchurch victims, if not all of it. Now, joining me now for tonight's Taking Stock is Shivani Gopal, CEO of The Remarkable Woman, and Scott Phillips, Chief Investment Officer at The Motley Fool. Thank you both for being with me. It's a really difficult topic here, but the one thing that has just been so incredibly held up, and people have been celebrating it and talking about it non-stop, is the egg boy, the person who took matters into his own hand with an egg and basically took it upon himself to shut up Fraser Anning. What did you make of it, Shivani?
Yeah, you can really understand his motivations, can't you? I mean, his actions really reflected what the entire nation was feeling about Anning, because what he said was completely atrocious, should have no place in an elected official, let alone in the country at all. But the thing that worries me is the sort of uplift it gives to the alt-right movement, because a week ago no one knew who Anning was, and now the entire nation is talking about him. There's been a million signatures towards a petition to get him out of parliament, but there's no constitution to actually do that, so you can't really achieve that, right? But at the same time, you've got the white supremacy movement having somewhat of a legitimate poster boy, as a result of all the fame that has come associated with Egg Boy. So I think that whilst you can really understand where Egg Boy is coming from, it sets a dangerous precedent. But also, you know, Australia by and large is a non-violent country. And what also concerns me is the one-upness of this. What happens when the next time that a politician says something that's completely out of line, completely atrocious, and someone thinks, well, I'm going to take matters into my own hand, but I need to take a little bit step further this time and one-up this last stunt. That could be quite worrying to see what the translation of that would be.
Yeah, it certainly received a lot of media attention. Scott, what did you make of Egg Boy?
It's one of those strange situations where it almost kind of should be the thing of fiction, right? You think about the whole context of the story and you think, okay, well, some ridiculous comment by Senator Shivani's point, then an egg that all of a sudden rises to national attention. Egg Boy himself now, of course, a folk hero for some. And to Shivani's point, this is reprehensible commentary from someone who should know better, someone who should do better. Remember, of course, this is the man who was elected with 19 votes, we should say, who was, through a series of changes in terms of the pre and post election, ends up in parliament with some sort of voice. To Shivani's point, we do run the risk of giving him more of a voice. If there is a positive out of this, it's both parties for probably the first time actually coming out and actively condemning this sort of stuff. We've seen in the past that some of the parties have gone some of the way towards addressing it. Most have left it alone or sort of tacitly not approved it, but just kind of, you know, the whole, was it David Hurley, the general of the Australian Army, saying the standard you walk past, the standard you accept? Mm-hmm. The good thing about this is there are people now not walking past this and saying, actually, no, from, you know, frankly, the likes of Tony Abbott, who otherwise would have been seen as on the right of politics and maybe in the past have seen this go through. Mm-hmm. Scott Morrison, similarly, have both come out very, very clearly, as we saw in the package, and saying, no, this is not okay, and here's why. And that's, I think that's a positive. I think I do agree with Shivani's point, though. At some level, it's the old question. You know, Tony Abbott was punched in Tasmania by a bloke who was then jailed, and justifiably so. This was an egg; it wasn't doing any damage. But we also need to be a little bit careful, I think. I don't want to be accused of being on Fraser Anning's side, because I'm clearly not. But there is some standard of decency to an elected official or not, just simply say, is that an appropriate way to treat anybody? I don't think it is. And Shivani's point, when do you then go further and under what circumstances? If it had been a different scenario, if the egg boy had been the white supremacist and there'd been a left-leaning parliamentarian and the same thing was done, would we think it was okay? And different people will say yes to what people are saying yes now. So it's kind of important that we don't set a standard behaviour or excuse behaviour just because we happen to agree or disagree with the participants.
Shivani, I was just going to say that one of the most interesting things that I've read about this today was in the Sydney Morning Herald, which is that this is history repeating itself.
Yeah.
100 and something years ago, Billy Hughes, who was the Prime Minister, got pelted with eggs because he was trying to push forward a conscription bill for World War I. So he got hit with the eggs. The story goes that he reached for a gun, which he didn't actually have, a pistol.
Thank God for
Thank goodness, exactly. How times have changed on the actual response,
right.
I guess. But, you know, I don't suppose that that Egg Boy himself, Will Connolly, knew about that story. But it's funny how it just kind of, that's the choice that he decided to make. That's the way he wanted to express himself.
Yeah.
And people have been doing it a similar way for a long time.
But what's so interesting about that is the core of that kind of person hasn't changed, right? Over 100 years ago, he reached for his gun, right? And you take a look at Anning's reaction. I mean, this is a man who should know better. He's a senator, and yet he smacked the boy twice. You know, so his actions are very telling that violence begets violence. So, of course, he didn't have a gun, and I'm not saying that if he did, he would, reach for it. But what I am saying is he did reach for violence, and he's not a 17-year-old kid. He needs to know better. He must do better. So, yes, we're looking at censure, coming up very soon. It's a real shame that, he can't be booted out of Parliament. The election has to do that for him. I don't really think, the precedent is good, but Senator Anning's reaction was woeful.
Yeah, it was certainly. We're going to have to move on time-wise. It was certainly a huge topic. It's really good to speak to you both about it. We wanted to move on to this other story that came across the desk today. Unearthed comments made by Jeff Bezos back in 1999 showed just how long he had basically a clear plan for. Back when Amazon was just a 5-year-old book retailer, Bezos was planning for the end of shopping malls, the birth of e-commerce, the Internet of Things, online advertising, immediacy, things like that. It's just staggering to see these sorts of comments. What do you think when you see 20-year-old comments from somebody who went on to become the richest person in the world, with the biggest company, all these sorts of things?
It's kind of easy to look back with some degree of survivorship bias. Well, of course he did, because look where he's come now, and of course he knew that, and of course, we tend to look at success stories and say, well, they knew or they did something special. And in a different version of the universe, Jeff Bezos is out of business because Walmart have sent him broke, and he's got this manifesto, probably a bad word in the context, he's got this document that we look at and say, look at the dreams he had, as if that was going to happen, right? Mm. And now it happens. That's amazing. Look what he's done. That being said, he has always, his annual letters every year to his investors, he includes the same year one letter that he sent to the very first set of shareholders to say, this is day one, here is our aim, here's what we're aiming to do. And so that very document from the listing of Amazon way back in the day is exactly the story of saying, look, we want to become the world's most customer-centric company. We're going to focus on the ultra long term. I don't want any directors on my board who care about what happens in the next 10 years. We're building a business for 10 years out. So to some degree, the objective is no different. I continue to be stunned by people like Bezos and others, the people who can see the future and see the Internet of Things, can see, that sort of stuff. Where we are now, I couldn't have imagined it 5 years ago, right? Mm-hmm. Some people could imagine it 10 years ago. Bezos, 2 decades ago, knew where we'd get to, and that is just phenomenal. That's what separates. You can copy Bezos step by step by step, and you're not going to get where he got, because he's just got that. We overuse the word vision, right? The vision thing, as Paul Keating called it. But he genuinely knew exactly where he wanted to go, and every decision he's made not only was for the long term, but was for the long term he envisaged. It's one thing to say, well, I'm aiming for a long term, which is different to where we get to, and then you go broke. He's done a fantastic job of not only being long term, but making the right bets along the way.
Yeah. Fascinating, isn't it? Shivani, we often talk to you about goal setting in the business world. Do you think about this in that context exactly?
Oh, goodness, yes. I mean, I was cheering when I read this because, we know Jeff Bezos to be a visionary, right? And he's so whiz. And you think about other entrepreneurs who've been incredibly successful and not just doing the usual business mold, which is, oh, I've got a business I want to launch. What am I going to do? Am I going to solve a problem or am I going to add value? He's gone, I'm going to look at something completely revolutionary and I'm going to aim towards that. And think about other incredible visionary entrepreneurs who haven't been shy about their vision for the world or their companies who've done similar things. You think about the late Steve Jobs. You think about Elon Musk, who just get out there and say, this is what I want to do. Mm. Forget about the competition. I am going to change the game. And you know what this reminds me of? So Bezos talked about, what was it? It was Barnes & Noble and how they viewed Amazon as competition. And he said, well, of course, they're viewing us as a competition right now because, they're just trying to, keep afloat. But in a year's time, they're not going to think of us as competition because we are looking to change the game entirely. And that's exactly what he did. And it reminds me of this book called Blue Ocean Strategy, which was written in 2005. So well after Bezos made these comments in 1999. And Blue Ocean Strategy is really stay away from the red ocean. So the red ocean is red and awash with blood, or from the cutthroat nature of competition, right? blue ocean strategy is I'm going to create a brand new value add, a brand new marketplace altogether that no one is playing in right now. Exactly what Musk has done, exactly what Steve Jobs did, exactly what Bezos has done. And so it's these kind of visionaries that look that far beyond in the future and say, I'm going to do something entirely different. That's what's so inspirational about this. Yeah. So I think it's a great story. And I think, yes, it's one that echoes why you can't just have a business plan and then just leave it there. You've got to go back to it and test it and have a look at all these different elements of the economy and what's changing in trends and look forward and think about how you're going to change the game. So I think it's brilliant. We should be talking about this with, you know, more and more entrepreneurs.
Absolutely. It's been fascinating to read through it, honestly. And you do kind of wonder in a way whether or not he really brought it about or whether or not it was going to come anyway and he was just predicting it, or whether he did see to the end of the shopping mall and, you know, the start of the hit a button and your dishwashing liquid ends up at your place. It's a fascinating conversation. I hope that we can revisit it in a future chat. This next one's an interesting one. The internet is making fun of J.K. Rowling's habit of dropping new details about Harry Potter characters not referred to in the books or movies. The latest is that Albus Dumbledore and Gellert Grindelwald had an incredibly intense sexual relationship. Do artists of all kinds need to know when to step away from the canvas? Or is this sort of thing okay? It's interesting. I'm curious. Shivani, what do you think about this?
Yeah, so I had to reach out to some of my friends who were some, you know, serious Harry Potter fans.
Yep.
Because I was worried that I was going to be egged about my comments on you know, J.K. Rowling and, you know, do not touch the goddess that is the creator of Harry Potter. Mm. But look, I think fans are really, you know, getting irked around the fact that you've created this fantasy world for us. We completely subscribe to it. We buy into it. And now you're tweaking things, right? So, you know, so there's a bit of that. But my take on this is she is the creator of Harry Potter. She can do whatever she likes, really. She wants to add a little bit of twist and turns, a new character there, and say they've got an intense sexual relationship. Power to you, sister. You can do that. Go write another book on it and go for it. I think it's great. And, you know, here we are talking about it, and, yeah, and you never know, she might have something in the works.
Maybe. Scott, what do you think? Are you a Harry Potter fan?
I'm not necessarily a huge Harry Potter. Most of my family are, to be fair. Okay, so, yeah. So my unblocks massively know it. Yeah. Look, I think in terms of... it is her creation, to Shivani's point. On the flip side, once you put these things into the public sphere, once it becomes so well adopted, you're kind of messing with people's... it's almost theirs as much as yours now, right? At some level, so many people are so invested in this story, they know exactly what's going on. It's kind of like when you see a movie made of a book, and you've read the book and you kind of think, you have a picture in your mind's eye of what the characters are and what they do and what they look like and how they talk. And you see it on the screen, you go, no, that's not right. That's not that person. And so you kind of, to some degree, wrecks the magic, because the idea of books is you've created this world for yourself. And whatever you've seen of these two characters and others, it's kind of, you know, what you've taken from the book as it's read, and the imagination does the rest. Mm. When someone comes in and says, yeah, that thing you imagined over there, that's not right anymore because I've decided this. Again, totally her right to do it. I think at some level that you kind of got to, as you say, step away from the canvas, let the public have this thing. You're passing over a creation, right, from you to them. They create their own imaginary worlds as they read the books. I kind of figure, let them have it. If you want to write a new book, write the new book, add to it, subtract from it. But just dropping in a hint after the fact and changing how people perceive characters, I don't know. Not a big fan.
Yeah, it's a difficult one. Some people say, well, why didn't you just include it in the book? It would have been a perfectly reasonable thing to have that as part of the narrative.
Exactly.
You know, why not? Look, it's something that I'm sure plenty of people, to your point, Shivani, will be happy to debate over Twitter time and time again here. Thank you very much, Shivani Gopal and Scott Phillips, for joining me here on Taking Stock here on Your Money Live.